Good morning, members of the committee and Chairman Gutowski. Thank you for your attention during today's hearing. For the record, my name is Lisa Bodwin, and for some reason, my heart is racing.
Take your time, don't.
Yeah.
Yeah, we don't bite. We'd love to have people come and talk to us. And you should feel good coming here and doing it, because we need your input. Thank you.
This is my third time at least before this committee.
Well, it should be getting easier, right?
It is. I currently serve as Executive Director of ABLE New Hampshire. We advocate for the full civil and human rights for people who experience disabilities. On behalf of our membership spanning across New Hampshire and our Board of Directors, I ask you to support HB 1816 as amended. Last year, during testimony of SB 155, you heard deep concerns about the inability of the New Hampshire legislature to evaluate the performance of the MCOs in Step 1 Medicaid managed care because financial analytics had not been provided. HB 1816 is a step in the right direction. This bill provides some measure of fiscal transparency and accountability. We are pleased the New Hampshire legislature is asserting its right to evaluate the fiscal performance of the MCOs. It's also occurred to me today as I've been sitting here that part of Step 1, one of the promises, was that New Hampshire might yield an adequate mental health network as a result of the move. That was one of the promises that was made. That promise has not been borne out. As to the second element of HB 1816, which says that the remaining unimplemented phases of Medicaid managed care program shall not be implemented for all the waivers, thank you to Rep. Kirk and his co-sponsors. You have listened to the voices of the people with disabilities and their families who, since the move to managed care was announced, we have been fighting against this. We fought against the passage of the original legislation. We supported SB 553. We supported SB 155. And we are now here again saying to you, the move of long-term services to a managed care organization model is not the model that will serve our families. ABLE conducted a survey in the fall. A full 94% of respondents indicated it was very or extremely important that New Hampshire retain a locally based service delivery system as elicited in RSA 171A, first drafted in 1975 and revised several times. It was and remains visionary in its attempt to create a high quality, person-centered care model for people who need and deserve support in their communities. It is financially super lean, accountable to the New Hampshire legislature, the Department of Health and Human Services, families, and provides a foundation for the justice that RSA 171A embedded into that legislation. It is the justice that New Hampshire citizens want for people who experience disabilities. I have to say, my son is not a consumer of services. He is a citizen who deserves the justice embedded in RSA 171A, and a move to an MCO model will make him a consumer, will give him a menu of services. That is not what the heart and soul of the people of New Hampshire want, and it's not about the justice for people with disabilities who deserve to be in the center of American life and not treated as if they're acute care patients. In October 2016, I will remind you, Camille Dobson of the National Association of the States United for Aging and Disabilities, an MCO MLTSS lobby group, gave a PowerPoint to a bunch of us at an SB 553 commission group meeting. We found out there that there are no national studies assessing the efficacy of Medicaid managed care long-term supports and services. New Hampshire, by the way, currently ranks third in quality of care and 34th in cost expenditures. Why are we still, years later, wasting time and resources trying to figure out how to transition to an MCO model of care that is not proven to increase quality, and in New Hampshire, hasn't proven to be cost-effective in step one. When Ms. Dobson was asked, what happens to wait lists in states when MCOs come in? She replied, states that have waiting lists still have waiting lists. Centene sends dividends to shareholders in other states. Centene in other states who run MLTSS programs send dividends to shareholders while our nation's most vulnerable citizens linger without services? That represents a gross injustice, and I would argue a takings from taxpaying citizens whose tax dollars directed to Medicaid ought to be spent on Medicaid recipients and their locally embedded workforce, not out-of-state shareholders. Currently, Able New Hampshire hears heartbreaking stories. Every single week, we get a phone call from families whose loved ones are lingering on wait lists. And now we are actually hearing stories of families whose existing budgets for adult services are being slashed to fund other families waiting on the wait list. Able New Hampshire has repeatedly told this committee, we will not abide a move to an MCO model of care which is unproven in its ability to deliver high quality care, has not proven to be cost effective, and leaves people on wait lists. Please support HB 1816. It is the will of the people of New Hampshire who are touched by disability. In addition, our current system is cost effective.
Thank you very much.